I Thank you. Come on and put those hands together all over the building. Come on, you can do better than that. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. How many of you happy to be in worship one more time? He's been good. He's been kind. He's been loving. He's looked beyond our faults, and he continues to meet all of our needs. Come on, turn to your neighbor. Put a big smile on your face. Tell him, I'm glad you're here. I'm glad you're here. Hallelujah. Come on, grab your Bibles. Grab your Bibles on this Sunday morning. Go with me to the book of James. Go with me to the book of James. When you get to the book of James, go to chapter number 5. James 5. We're going to start reading at verse number 13. And when you are there, just simply say, I'm there. James 5:13. James 5:13 says, is any among you in trouble? Let them pray. Is anyone happy? Let them sing songs of praise. Is any among you sick? Let them call the elders of the church to pray over them and anoint them with the oil in the name of the Lord. The prayer offered in faith will make the sick person well. The Lord will raise them up. If they've sinned, they will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for each other so that you may be healed. Let me read that again. Therefore, confess your sins to each other. Pray for one another so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. Every head is bowed and every eye is closed. Gracious God, our Father, we want to say thanks. For this is the day that you've made. We plan to rejoice and be glad in it. You've indeed been so kind to us this past week. And so, God, as we gathered in worship, allow us to worship you like we've never worshiped you before. We've gathered in your house. Please forgive us of our sins. Cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And allow us to give you praise that honors you. Bless everyone that has come to hear from you. Give us ears to hear your word. Make our heart receptive to worship. And if there's anything in us that is not like you, it is our prayer that you remove it. You've been good. You've been kind. And we command our mouths to praise you. We command our hands to clap. We command our voices to sing. But most importantly, our mind to be stayed on you. Now, Lord, remove any distractions so that we may gain a better understanding of you. It's in the name that woke us up early this morning. It's in the name that continues to hold us together. It's in the name of Jesus, and let the church say amen. Come on, amen one more time. Amen. One more time for the Holy Spirit. Come on, put those hands together. Come on and join us in worship with our praise team.
Good morning, First Baptist. Put those blessed hands together. Let's give God a hand and cup of praise again on this morning. How many know our God is awesome on this morning? And so because we serve awesome God, we're going to praise awesome God. So just join in with us on this morning for praise and worship.
If it wasn't for your love, wasn't for your grace,
stop here. What's it for?
If it wasn't for your love, wasn't for your grace, I don't know where I'd be without you.
Take it out. On this morning, for your awesome God. Here we go, you're awesome.
You are awesome. You are awesome. You are awesome. You are awesome. You are awesome. You are awesome.
Serve also God, that whatever you're dealing with, it's not over till God says so. He has the last and the final say so in everything in our lives. Thank you. Deliverer. He's a healer. Everything we need is in him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And on this morning, we bless you, Lord. Can we just say something just sweet and nice to our God right now? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you don't have anything else, say hallelujah works. Hallelujah, God. Thank you. Thank you, God. Hallelujah. We bless you on this morning, God. We bless you on this morning. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Worship on this morning. Come sing, join with us, and we all sing, bless the So can we just say, Lord, we bless you this morning and bless you, Lord.
Now put those hands together all over this church. Come on, come on. Don't fool me. If he's done great things, show some sign. Hallelujah. If he's done anything great in your life, show some sign. Hallelujah. Amen. You may be seated if you can. He's done great things. Hallelujah. He's done great things. Try one more time. He's done great things. Hallelujah. He woke you up this morning. That's a great thing. He allowed you to walk, talk, hear, see, taste, and smell. That's a great thing. You haven't lost your mind after all you've been through. You don't look like what you've been through. He's done great. He's done great things. Come on and bless his holy name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He's done great things. He's done great things. Well, this is the day that the Lord has made. We're going to rejoice. We're going to be glad in it. So glad to see all of you on this, the Lord's Day. Good morning. Come on, let me try that again. Good morning. Amen, amen. We celebrate God for all of you, for how he continues to bless, how he continues to keep all of us in the midst of this spring-like winter weather. We don't know what to wear, whether to put on shorts or whether to put on gloves. It just keeps on changing. But we thank God that we're able to experience the weather. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Celebrate God for all of you. We want to take this time to thank our youth and our men's ministry. Last weekend, they had a wonderful trip at the museum. We celebrate God for the youth and men. I'm told that they had a marvelous time in the Lord. Lord, if you've ever been to the African American Museum downtown, you understand that you start at the bottom, and then you have to work your way all the way up to the top. But starting at the bottom can be a painful thing. But when you get to the top, you can celebrate. Isn't that the way life is sometimes? And so we celebrate God and thank God for our youth and our men on last week. Amen. This coming Wednesday, we are fasting as we do every last Wednesday of the month from 6 a.m. to 12 p.m. We ask that you dedicate that time to the Lord. Amen. We are praying for Sister Georgie Peterson and her family. And the passing of her son, Melvin R. Peterson. We want to keep that family lifted in prayer. Services are this Friday, April 26th. Visitation is at 11 to 12. Services from 12 to 1 p.m. That will be held at the Alexander Funeral Home in Charlotte, North Carolina. So we want to keep Sister Peterson and her entire family lifted in prayer. Amen? Want to keep them lifted in prayer. You guys know what this upcoming weekend, and I don't ask you for a lot, but I do ask you to come out on this Friday as my pastor will be coming in town, and I want him to see all your loving faces. Let me try that again. I want him to see all your loving faces. So we want to invite people to our house. We want them to be here when they come. So this Friday at 7 p.m., we'll kick off our pastoral anniversary celebrations, 9 wonderful years. Come on, put your hands together. Amen, amen. Then on next Sunday, my good friend, the Reverend Dr. Stephen Jesse Russell from the Calvary Baptist Church in Baltimore will be our morning preacher. We'll celebrate in high fashion. And so we're so thankful to what God has done for 9 wonderful years. I want to add a little thing to that. This is always around our wedding anniversary. This coming Thursday, First Lady and I will celebrate 26 years of marriage. And so we are so thankful and appreciative to God for all the wonderful things that he continues to do. And we just celebrate God. Amen. I'm going to ask that Sister Paulette Ellis will come, and she's going to give a special announcement. After she shall come, then our praise team will come with our sermonic selection. Amen. Come on and bless her as she comes.
Good morning, First Baptist. Have heard the announcements. I am going to add a little special treat to the announcement. Pastor Ivy, please stand. On behalf of the Pastor's Aid Ministry and in the memory of our beloved Sister Shirley Williams, we will bless the Lord at all times. Pastor Ivy, if Sister Shirley was here today, she would say to you, is there anything you need, Pastor? We, the members of the First Baptist Church of Marshall Heights, we echo the same question. Pastor Ivy, is there anything we can do for you? Please let us know. We will continue to support you and pray for you and your family. Be encouraged. And know that if God is for you, if God is for our pastor, when God is for you, who can be against him? Be blessed with the favor of God. And once again, happy anniversary. And to you, in the memory of our sister,
in the narrow way. I'll keep my life.
Come on and be so kind to rest on your feet all over the building. Amen. Come on, grab your Bibles. Go with me to the Gospel according to Luke. When you get to Luke, I want you to go to the 13th chapter. Get to the 13th chapter, I want you to go down to verse number 10, and when you are at verse number 10, just simply say, I'm there. Every head is bowed and every eye is closed. Gracious God, for the privilege of standing behind this sacred desk, we once again say thank you for how you've been so good, gracious, and kind to all of us. Now, God, I ask that you would allow your anointing to fall that makes preaching easy. Bless these your people on today, God, but more importantly, let your word go forth with boldness, power, and clarity. It's in your son's name, and we all say amen. Come on, if you found the scripture, just say amen. Luke 13, starting with verse number 10, it reads as follows. On a Sabbath, Jesus was teaching in one of the synagogues. A woman was there who had been crippled by a spirit for 18 years. Text says she was bent over and could not straighten up at all. When Jesus saw her, he called her forward and said to her, woman, you are set free from your infirmity. Then he put his hands on her, and immediately she straightened up and praised God. You may be seated. I want to also read it out of the Message Bible. I love how Eugene Peterson writes it. He was teaching in one of the meeting places on the Sabbath. There was a woman present, so twisted and bent over with arthritis that she couldn't even look up. She had been afflicted with this for 18 years. When Jesus saw her, he called her over, woman, you are free. He laid his hands on her, and suddenly she was standing straight up and tall, giving glory to God. I want to title this message, Holy Spirit Guiding, from the simple theme, I will not stay this way. Jesus is on the move again, as always in the Gospel of Luke, providing help and healing to anyone in need. Continues to attempt to help his disciples see the importance of ministry, which is meeting the needs of others. Our Savior delivers each day, gives new meaning to life, allows for multiple chances, and cannot go by someone, hear me, without lending a hand. He's so compassionate and loving that when he sees the need, his only response is to meet that need. My hope today is that you have a need and you're not ashamed to bring your needs to him, because he's more than willing to turn around what is attempted to keep you bound. The woman in our text has never given a name. She's defined by her condition. No family is mentioned at all, and all we know about her is that she has a condition that has bothered and hampered her life, hear me, for 18 years. I'm going to say it again, because the climate of the day, no name is given, and all we know is about her ailment. And I wrestled with this scenario, deacons, because I just wonder if we continue to identify individuals by what they go through, or what conditions they have, the illnesses that they deal with, then maybe we never get to fully know them. Now, I believe Jesus wants to move us from being named by a condition so that people will now look at her for what she brings to the table and not the illness that has attempted to get the best of her. Can you be honest with me that labels can be destructive, can cause more problems than solutions, will make others shy away from us because they know us by our conditions? And if you're honest this morning, you know some folk and you don't even know their name, but you know them by their condition. And I'm simply suggesting, church, that Jesus wants to know each and every one of us by name. That alleviates some of the alienation and isolation that we may feel when we're going through. But can I help you on this morning? This sister comes from a family, has parents, has relatives, has co-workers or former co-workers, and people know her outside of the confines of the church. But when we meet her, none of these things are brought to light. All we know is she has a condition that she's been dealing with for 18 years. Bothers me, Charles, because she's just like some of us, and we've allowed the labels and the identifiers to derail our destiny to the point that when others see us, they don't really see who we are, but they see our condition and relegate us to an illness and never address us by name. And I just suspect that each time Jesus finds himself in the midst of persons with various conditions, his nature is to bring wholeness to brokenness, health to illness, joy to pain, hope to despair, and life to death-like situations. And all of us here today, you can remember a time in which life hit you so hard, it felt like it literally knocked the breath out of you. And the only recourse you had was turning to Jesus. If you can identify with me today, then I need for you to talk back. If you're not there, just keep living, because life has a way of sometimes catching us off guard. Another time, allowing us to live with the conditions that we thought by now should have been worked out. Can you be honest with me? You thought by now some things should have been worked out. That some things should not still bother you some 5 years later. Some things should have been turned around. Some prayers should have been answered. Some illnesses should be out of your body. But every day you wake up, can I tell you, it's a good day, because God is not through with you yet. I'm glad that she knew something about encouraging herself and did not wait for others to recognize or acknowledge her, but she still came to church, hear me, and worship with her arthritis. She helps us because her condition did not keep her home, but it pushed her to worship. And when she got to worship, she didn't complain about arthritis, but she took her seat and began to worship God. And I don't know about you, but her condition did not stop her from church on Sunday or Bible study on Wednesday. Her condition allowed her to be around the saints of God. And all I'm trying to do is to press upon you that our conditions, regardless of how bad they may seem, can I tell you, it can be a catalyst for progress if we no longer allow things to hold us down. And on this morning, there are believers with conditions that could have allowed you to stay home, but instead you got up, put your clothes on and said, I would rather be in church with my issues than sitting at home having a personal pity party. At least I'm around other saints. She makes her way to worship. She gets there, she's not disappointed, because she knows that since she's in church, anything may happen. But let me see if I can help. You ever come to church not feeling in the best condition? You've told yourself even before you got to church, I don't really feel like going today. I don't want to see anybody. I'm going to sit right there. I'm going to fold my hands. I'm not going to clap. I'm not going to sing. I hope the pastor doesn't say, turn to your neighbor 4 and 5 times. I don't want to turn to anyone. He knows what I'm going through. But something happened in the middle of worship. Somebody sang a song. Somebody uttered a prayer. The word hit you, and before you know it, you started moving around, and you started feeling better. And after a while, you forgot about what you were complaining about. And I don't know who I'm talking to on this Sunday morning, but this sister teaches us that encouragement begins from the inside, and then it works its way to the outside. You know why I say that? Because after 18 years of living with a sickness, she had to have inner fortitude for her to press her way to church every Sunday. Every Sunday she wakes up. The Bible says she has a condition that's so bad that she has to walk in a bent over position. That even when she gets to church, she can't even sit straight up in the pew. She has to listen to the preacher and listen to the choir in a bent over state. Who can agree with me today? Because of the outside in this season, it may look jacked up, out of control, the wind may be blowing, but the inner peace and the calm of God has allowed you to keep going. And I believe this sister could be on the front of a Hallmark card, and her picture and the caption can say, "Don't allow your outward condition to disrupt your inner peace." Can I tell you somebody on this Sunday morning, I don't care what's happening on the outside. As long as you got Jesus on the inside, then everything is going to be all right. She teaches us some valuable lessons and encouragement. It does not permit her illness to take precedent over the praises of God. Does not allow her pain to stop her pursuit of God. But she comes to church even when she don't feel like coming to church. Sits there and listens to the preacher, and she is so bent over, the text says she can't even straighten up. And I have some questions for you, and I'll be out of your way. Has your life ever felt like stuff went so wrong that you felt that God had allowed you to be bent over and he wouldn't straighten you up? Have you ever gone through a season that had you bent over and not able to stand up? The loss of a loved one, the hurt from a broken relationship, the medical test that did not give the results you wanted, the out-of-nowhere call that still has you wanting to lay in the bed with the covers over your head, the child that keeps you on your knees, the job that has you looking for the weekend when you get to work on Monday. And the list goes on and on. But I want to testify and help someone. I know what it feels like to be bent over. I know what it feels like when you can't straighten up. But can I tell you, if you keep coming, God has a way of finding you and meeting your needs so that you won't stay in that condition. What does the text teach us? Well, the first thing, she's intentional about her situation. Say intentional. And I love this because she did not wait for Jesus, but she went to him. One would think after 18 years, she would have thrown in the towel, got weary and wanting better, but never getting better. She's so intentional that she goes to church in her condition, and when she gets there, she acts as if nothing is wrong. Okay, let me say it again, Cole. Some of y'all want everybody to know what's going on with you. You come in looking broke down, looking messed up, and everybody can tell what's going on. But there are others of us who come in even with pain, even with heartache, and we act as if everything is all right. Because the Bible says where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty, and the captives are set free. I'm just glad to be in the service one more time. Never says that she's trying to get the attention of Jesus, but goes to church, hear me, participates in worship, and does not blame her condition on others or Jesus. I need to say it again. She's not angry, nor is she upset, but presses her way to the church, and when she got there, she was not complaining, but worshiping. And I hope you and I can come to the point that Jesus knows about us, and when we're intentional about our situation, he will see about us. But what I really mean is that it's your reasonable service to be in church and don't allow what you face to keep you home. In actualities, with some of the issues we are facing, you ought to be kicking the doors down come Sunday morning, because you know what you got to face on Monday morning. You know who you got to see on Tuesday morning. And you know who you live with all 7 days. So come Sunday, you ought to be saying, this is the day that the Lord has made. We're going to rejoice and be glad in it. And I thought to myself, what it must have felt like to be in church but not even able to sit up straight. In spite of what she felt physically, she believed that whatever Jesus had to say was greater than the pain she was in, which is what's so important. Don't neglect church or Jesus because he's waiting for you and he wants to meet all of your needs. The second thing that I like is that she ignored her pain and embraced worship. She ignored her pain and embraced worship. 18 years of waking up with a bent-up body. And I'm quite sure she's been to doctors, she's been to specialists, she's been to the rehab center, but nothing changed her condition. Let me say it again, 18 years and no one could figure out how to help her straighten up. She done gave out all these co-pays, been in rehab and physical therapy, but at the end of the day, she's still bent over and she can't walk right. What I love about her is that she ignored her pain and she still came to church. Because I believe when we get to the point and we are less concerned about how we feel and what we're going through and embrace worship, Jesus sees us. Can I say it again? Ignore what hurts, what ails you, and embrace worship. If this sister can come to church in her condition, then nothing should keep you home. A cold shouldn't keep you home. Your back hurting shouldn't keep you home. Your toenail popping off shouldn't keep you home. You waking up a little late, even if you're late, come on in here. Nothing should keep you home when you think about what he's done, the ways he's made, the doors he's opened, and how he continues to bless you in spite of you. You ought to make it to worship. Now, there's something about worship that cannot be experienced from a screen. Something about worship that you can't get virtually, because when the saints get together, the energy and the spirit is what helps us. While she's in worship, ignoring her pain, Jesus sees her, calls her forward, and he tells her that you are now going to be free from your infirmity. And I stop by because Jesus always, not sometimes, shows up just when we need her. He speaks words of healing over her. Let me say it again. The woman is set free from her infirmity, but the text says she's still bent over. Some scholars have the nerve to say, was Jesus having a bad day? Because he tells her, woman, you are set free from your infirmity. But the text says she's still bent over. He spoke what was supposed to turn her life around. And sometimes Jesus speaks to us, and that's not enough. Sometimes he has to go another route. Remember, she's intentional about her situation, ignored her pain, and lastly, she's impressed by Jesus and expresses gratitude. And I could not get this out of my head all week. Jesus speaks healing, but her arthritis is not cleared up. He speaks, but she's still bent over. He speaks, but she doesn't seem to be healed. And I love Jesus because sometimes we need for him not just to speak, but to put his hands on us. Let me say it again. He didn't just speak, but the Bible says he spoke, put his hands on her, and she immediately straightened up. Some of you are still looking at me funny. The woman had not been touched in so many years, lived in isolation because of her condition. She was considered unclean, and no one touched her. Jesus understood his speaking to her was great, but she needed to be touched by the one
who can do all things well. And if we're honest on this Sunday morning, it's okay for Jesus to speak, but every now and then you need him to put his hands on you. You need him to touch you. You need him to heal you with his healing hands. And some of us just need to be touched, and I can assure you all things will be well. But I'm so glad he touched her, and when he touched her, the Bible says she immediately straightened up. Sadness turned into happiness. Despair became hope. The thought of giving up turned into perseverance. And when she was touched by Jesus, her life immediately changed. And I got a question for you. When Jesus touched you, did your life immediately change? Okay, that's a weak response for a great question. When Jesus touched you, did your life immediately change? Okay, I'm going to try it one more time. When Jesus saved you, did your life immediately change? Well, I would be a bad theologian if I left you alone without the last phrase. It says she was touched, and the Bible says immediately she straightened up, but she did one more thing. It said she praised God. Okay, maybe you missed it. After being in pain for 18 years, she's touched by Jesus, and then she straightens up, and you know what she does? She starts to give God praise. Okay, y'all missed your shot. I'm going to try it again. She had not stood up straight in 18 years. Jesus touches her. She stands up straight, opens up her mouth, and begins to give God praise. I'm going to try it one more time. She had not stood up straight in 18 long years. Jesus touches her, and after he touches her, she gives him praise. And I wonder if there's anybody in the building on a Sunday morning that because he touched you, you know what the next thing you should do, and that's to open up your mouth, put your hands together, and give him praise. Because he's touched your family, he's touched your marriage, he's touched your children, he's touched your mind and kept you in perfect peace. Because the Bible says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. And every time he touches you, you ought to say, I'll bless the Lord at all times. And his praise shall continually be in my mouth. I'll bless him in the morning. I'll bless him at noon. I'll bless him at night. I'll bless him on the mountain. I'll bless him in the valley. I'll bless him when I'm tired. I'll bless him when I got a lot of energy. Because every time I turn around, he keeps on blessing me. Every time I turn around, he keeps on opening doors. He touched me. Hear me. It's a challenge for the modern church. We don't know when to clap, and we don't know when to praise God. You're sitting here today, not because you're so bright, not because you're so good, not because you look so good. You're simply sitting here because early this morning, it wasn't the alarm clock. It wasn't your spouse. He touched you, and when he touched you, you were able to get up. Got up out of your bed, was able to walk, talk, hear, see, taste, and smell. Every once in a while, you ought to give him praise. Hear what I'm saying. This is all I came to tell you today. I don't care how bad it gets, staying home is not an option. Now let me be clear, because I know what some of y'all can do. Now, if you got something contagious, you stay home. But I'm talking about the little ailments that we make up on Sunday morning. It's raining outside. So what? You go to work when it rains. You don't call your supervisor and say, it's raining, I ain't coming in today. You go to the party when it's raining. So if you can do all those things, then you ought to come to church as much as you can. But this is the part that got me. When Jesus touches her, she immediately straightens up. And then she gives him a praise, hear me, that matches the blessing. The challenge I have with some of us is that our praise doesn't match the blessings that he gives to us. Sometimes a hand clap isn't enough. Sometimes the waving of a hand isn't enough. When he's pulled you out of the muck and miry, when he's taken you places that only he could take you, when he's been better than good to you, you ought to just tell him thank you because you've been so good. Thank you because you kept me when I could not keep myself. Thank you because I wanted to give up, but you wouldn't let me. Thank you because I wanted to throw in the towel. You took the towel and threw it back in my face. Thank you because you're just that good.
This is my challenge. It's my challenge. I don't care how bad it gets. I don't care how rough it gets. Don't stop coming to church. Did y'all hear what I said? I don't care how bad it gets. You can get up out of that bed. You done worked and cut your grass. You done did the flowers. You did all that. If you did all that with all that energy, you can come to church. Let me look at my deacons for a moment. My trustee, you do all that stuff in the yard. Not me, because I don't do that. But you did all that stuff in the yard, you can still come to church. Don't allow, hear me, small issues to prevent you from being in the place. Because hear me, and I'm really finished. She wasn't healed at home. The Bible says Jesus sees her in church, stops his teaching, goes over to her in the middle of a worship experience, touches her, and she's immediately healed. So can I tell you, sometimes God is looking for you on a Sunday morning because he wants to do it in front of folk so that folk can see that all power belongs to him. Come on, stand on your feet all over the building. Come on, you gotta get to the point where you're determined that you will not stay this way. Sometimes you gotta preach your own sermon. Anybody ever preach their own sermon? Come on, don't be ashamed. Anybody just got up on a day and it just was rough and you ain't really wanna go to work? Because you knew what you had to deal with when you got to work. Come on, can y'all talk to me at least? You ever been that way? All y'all must love y'all. All y'all love y'all jobs in here, right? Okay. Well, there were days that I would have to preach myself happy just to go to work. Because I used to do inpatient psychiatry. That means I would go on a locked unit. And when I would go on the locked unit, the door behind me would lock. And so I was on a unit with 28 patients who were not the best. So sometimes I had to look in the mirror, preach myself happy so that I wouldn't lose my mind. Okay, let me try it again. And so I got so happy that the work didn't bother me because I knew Jesus was with me. Sometimes you gotta preach yourself happy. Every head is bowed and every eye is closed. God, we come in the name of Jesus. Truthfully, God, we have no reason to complain. No reason to miss being in your presence. Because I'm praying over people who the doctor said would never straighten up. I'm praying over people who the therapist said the marriage has no chance. I'm praying over people who probation officer said the kids are never going to get right. Somewhere in the midst of all of that, you touched all of those situations. And now when the doctor had only given us 6 months, here we are 3 years later, still in worship. You hadn't removed it, but you still allowed us or our golden moments to roll on. So God, today we say thank you. Help us to never allow our issues to prevent us from being in worship. Because when we're in worship, you see us. And when you see us, you have to respond to us because you are a man of your word. So God, I don't know who I'm praying for on this Sunday morning, but I'm praying for the person that needs you to see them in worship.
God, heal them right now. Don't allow the benediction to get here before you meet their need. Make the crooked places straight. Take the anxiety away and let them live in perpetual peace. Heal the sickness, and we'll be so careful to give you the praise. So God, we say thank you in advance for being great, because you are indeed greatly to be praised. Help us to never allow what we deal with to prevent us from giving you our best. God, I'm preaching over people this morning that have arthritic conditions, but they thought it not robbery to be in worship. So God, bless them right where they are. Meet all of their needs. Open doors and do what only you can do, and that's bless them. It's in the name of Jesus. All God's children say amen. I don't know where you are all over the sanctuary, but I want to let you know that God sees you. Sometimes that's enough. He sees you. I know you come in, you worship, and you run out, but he sees you. When he sees you, he knows what you're dealing with. You can't hide from him. You can hide from us, but he knows what you're wrestling with. So I want to give you a chance today. If you're not saved, if you're not in a relationship with Jesus, the first call is for the person who wants to come and make a commitment, and you want to walk with him. Second call is maybe you are saved, but you are in search of a church home. And I want to offer you a chance to come and walk and join the First Baptist Church of Marshall Heights. Wherever you are over the sanctuary, do me one favor. Turn to your neighbor and say, is the preacher talking to you? Come on, I'll walk with you. Come on, say, is he talking to you? We don't do it a lot here, but I want to offer an altar call today. If you're in need of prayer, I want you to come right here and meet me at this altar. Don't be ashamed. Come on and meet me at the altar. Come on, meet me at the altar. There are several concerns that caught the attention of our church, and we want to be so sure that we lift these concerns. We want to lift these individuals. Come on, I'll wait for you. There's no rush. Come on to this altar. Come on. Don't be afraid. Come on. Y'all come up closer. They're coming behind you. Come. Come on. I'm glad you're here at the altar. I want you to know that prayer still works. I'm challenged as a pastor because I switched my sermon up in the midst of sitting there. But our church is going to go into a serious season of prayer because I think that's what we're missing. We're missing prayer, and I mean authentic prayer. Not show off prayer, but talking to God about what's on our mind. And I see all of you standing here today. There are all types of concerns at this altar. Some of you are sick and you haven't shared it with anyone that you're sick. Some of you are wrestling with all kind of things. And I want you to know, as the sermon said, God sees you. Every head is bowed and every eye is closed. God, we come in the precious and the powerful name of Jesus. God, before we ask you for anything, we want to thank you for everything. God, we want to take this time just to utter thanks to you for your kindness, for your grace, for your mercy, for being better to us than we've been to ourselves. And then, God, we want to thank you for your darling son, Jesus, who died on an old rugged cross, gave his life so that we could have eternal life. God, he died. They put him in a borrowed tomb, but he got up on the third day with all power in his hands. Because he got up, God, we can get up from anything that holds us down. So, God, the hand I'm holding right now, I squeeze into that hand a greater peace. I squeeze into that hand a greater anointing. I
squeeze into that hand healing and deliverance. God, I squeeze into that hand that cancer can't have you. Squeeze into that hand that diabetes can't have you. I squeeze into that hand hypertension can't have you. But not just that, God, I squeeze into that hand that anxiety, depression, that it can't have you. Worry can't win. But you're going to win in all of this. So God, for those who are sick, we lift them to you. Sister Michelle Quarterbaum, we lift her to you, God. Sister Carol Jones, we lift her to you, God. We lift them knowing that you're God and you're God all by yourself. So God, move like you've never moved. Move. Touch my neighbor, God. I don't know what their issue is, but God, you work it out. And God, don't work it out when they get home. Work it out right now. Do it immediately. Then, God, we're going to do like the lady in our text. After you touch us, we're going to have enough sense to open up our mouths and say thank you. So, God, we're going to thank you in advance because the battle is not ours. It's yours. Help us to stop carrying things that you are supposed to carry. Help us to stop worrying about things that you're going to take care of. So God, we love you. And we thank you. We declare victory. Victory over our health. Victory over our family. Victory over our children. Victory over our finances. In the name of Jesus. Let all of us say amen. Come on, give somebody a big hug and say, it's done. It's done. It's done. Hallelujah. Come on, come on, come on. Give somebody a hug. Tell them I'm praying for you. Tell them I'm praying for you. Tell them I'm praying. I'm praying. I'm praying for you. I'm praying for you. Hallelujah. 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 I want that to be your testimony all week, that God sees you, that he sees you. He knows what you're dealing with. God sees you. He knows your pain. He sees you. I'm going to say it again. God sees you. He knows what you're dealing with. He sees you, and he can handle all of your stuff. Hear me, and mine, all at the same time. He sees you. He sees you. Come on, put those hands together one more time. Put those hands together one more time. Hallelujah. Come on, grab your tithe, grab your offering, grab your seeds of hope. Come on, grab your tithe, grab your offering, and grab your seeds of hope. We believe that when we give unto God, he gives back to us in a miraculous way. And I want to help you this morning. Sometimes he doesn't bless you dollar for dollar, quarter for quarter, 100 bill for 100 bill. Sometimes this is what he does. He keeps you from getting sick. He prevents you from getting into an accident. He takes care of your children when you're not around. So we want to gather our tithe, our offering, and our seeds of hope, and we want to prepare to give unto the Lord. Come on, every head is bowed and every eye is closed. Gracious God, our Father, for the privilege and for the responsibility of giving, take these moments and we take this time to prepare our gifts to give unto you. God, your word says that you love a cheerful giver. So God, as we give, whether we give electronically or whether we give in the house, we want to thank you in advance that you would bless each and every gift, because your word says every good and perfect gift, it comes from you. So God, bless us as a church through our tithes, our offering, and our seeds of hope. It's in your son's name. And let the church say amen. Come on, give us some great giving music. Come on, give us some great giving music. Come on, this Friday, I want to see all of you in the building. Come on, wave your hand if you're going to try your best to get here on Friday. Come on, I don't want any of you to be missing. This is a celebration of pastor and people, and my pastor is coming all the way from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. He texted me early this morning, said, I cannot wait to get there to see the great people of the First Baptist Church of Marshall Heights. I hope you'll join us on Friday at 7 p.m. right here in the building as we're going to celebrate pastor and people. And then on Sunday, we'll be back in the building. This is what I want you to do. I want you to pray that God would do a miraculous thing in your life this week. Then I have a special prayer because I ask that you lift Emily in prayer as she's going into the last week of her classes. Come on, celebrate. Come on, come on. And it is tough when you raise an overachiever. She's at the end of her journey. She's only made 2 B's out of all the years. And I told her the other night, I said, if you don't do nothing, the last 2 weeks is good with me. She said, Dad, I'm not like you. I'm going to do all I can to finish strong. Because I compared my GPA to her GPA, added First Lady's GPA, and we still ain't get close to her. Amen. So we celebrate God for her. Hear me clearly. May 11th, we'll be in Cincinnati, Ohio. You won't see me because I'll be filling the Cintas Arena with tears of joy. Did y'all hear me? Can I just take a moment of pastoral privilege? Can I just do that? And I'm not bragging, but I'm just so happy. I told you guys that our daughter was born premature. The doctors didn't even think she would be able to walk. And here we are some 22 years later, the devil is a liar. Hallelujah. I'm excited. She did give us some instructions. She said, don't embarrass me. I said, you know, that's what parents do. That's what parents do. So we celebrate God. We thank God. We have others who are graduating, and we'll celebrate them during our time of Profiles of Excellence. We're just excited about what God is doing in and through our lives. I want to see you on Friday here at 7 p.m. Come on, put those hands together. Come on, turn to your neighbor and say, God sees you. God sees you. Come on, let us look to the Lord. God, we love you. We adore you. We lift you. We thank you. And now, God, allow us to leave this place better. Allow us to leave this place thanking you because you've touched all of us. It is in the name of Jesus we thank you. We adore you. Now may the grace and peace of God, sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, rest, fill, and abide with all of God's children now, henceforth, and forevermore. And all those who've been touched by Jesus, let the church say amen. Come on, give somebody a big hug.